Nadaljujemo z naslednjim predavanjem. Profesor Graziano Onder from Geriatric Department of Catholic University from Rome will present us a lecture on challenges of treating frail patients in geriatric services.
So thank you, Branko. Thank you very much for the invitation here. So the focus of my talk will be on challenges of treating frail patients in geriatric services. I will try to summarize here results of two big projects, two joint actions that I was involved in. The first of it is the joint action advantage. You will hear more about this later on. Clearly, probably you all know this project. And the second project is the joint action CRODIS, in which also your National Institute of Public Health is involved in, and which is much focused on chronic diseases and multimorbidity. These two joint actions have some overlaps, and I will show you part of the results of this project during my presentation. So what is the challenge? What is the real problem? We are all aware of the fact that the challenge is this modern patient, the geriatric patient, the complex patient, frail patient. We can call it him or her in different ways. But the concept is that this patient that is challenging our healthcare system has multiple impairments in different areas and organs. Not only clinical impairments and clinical problems, such as multimorbidity or polypharmacy, but also impairments and deficit in different non-clinical areas, cognition, function, mood, social status, geriatric syndromes. So this is the complexity of frailty, the complexity that our healthcare systems are facing in the last 20 years. Our healthcare systems are organized on the traditional so-called single disease approach, which is clearly not really valid for this kind of patients. And also research, clinical research, but also public health research, has probably shied away from this kind of complexity, and therefore it's very, very difficult to find approaches and valid strategies for this kind of person. Multimorbidity and chronic diseases are clearly a relevant part of this spectrum. What is multimorbidity? This is the focus of the joint action CRODIS, at least our participation, at least our work package in the joint action CRODIS. Multimorbidity is defined as the co-occurrence of two or more chronic conditions, two or more non-communicable diseases. It is the rule, not the exception. It affects about two-thirds of the population 65 or older. So it is extremely common, and it really impacts on outcomes and costs. As I said before, the traditional single disease approach, which is focused on a single disease, on a single condition, is really challenged by this, by the occurrence of multimorbidity, and is not adequate to persons with multimorbidity. This graph just to describe you the multimorbidity wave that affects mainly people 65 or older, so it becomes the rule rather the exception after after the age of 65. But as I said a bit at the beginning, clinical factors, multimorbidity and polypharmacy, are one of the aspects of one of the problems, because there are other non-clinical factors that strongly contribute to the complexity of frail patients. And this was said before. These are the results of one review of the literature we performed for the joint action advantage, where we clearly showed that there's a link and some overlap between frailty and chronic diseases. There's a substantial overlap. But frailty is a different condition. There are people with multimorbidity, many people with multimorbidity, who are not frail. And there are frail people who do not have multimorbidity. So the two concepts are linked and do overlap, but they're not exactly the same thing. We are wrong if we think that frailty and the complexity of frailty may be simply addressed by clinical factors and by clinical issues. I'm very proud of this article that our group in Rome did produce more than 10 years ago. In these articles, we looked at predictors of hospitalization in a population receiving home care. And what we clearly showed was that really diseases had a great impact. But also great impact was determined on hospitalization, so a pure clinical outcome. was also determined by non-clinical factors such as loneliness and economical problems. This is to tell everybody that if we really want to address the issue of hospitalization, reduce hospitalization, we cannot not only focus on diseases, but we also have to consider other non-clinical factors as a part of this complexity. And this is an historical paper, a very relevant one, published in the New England Journal of Medicine 2009, looking at rehospitalization. 20% of those discharged from hospital are rehospitalized in a 30-day period. And what are the strongest determinants of this rehospitalization? I'm sorry, it's written small, are disability and income. So non-clinical factors that clearly contribute to this complexity. So this data clearly tells us that if we want to focus on frailty and on this challenge of this modern patient, we cannot really rely simply on clinical factors, but we should consider the person and a more holistic approach rather than a clinical approach. So let's go to the definition of this geriatric service. What are the steps that are mandatory, that are necessary to define a geriatric service focused on frailty and eventually on multimorbidity? So there are three key steps that we underlined in this paper. The first step is the first contact. The first contact of the person with the service or with the practice. And the first contact means screening the person and identify those who are in need of an intervention. This is the concept of risk stratification and targeting intervention that is absolutely necessary in order to identify the persons that are in need of an intervention that should enter the geriatric service or any kind of practice focused on frailty. Older people may have different characteristics. At least in my country, 20% of the population, more than 20% of the population, and there are 60 million people living in Italy, are 65 or older. They cannot be, not all of them can enter a geriatric service. Not all of them should receive a specific care. So this first step is absolutely necessary to understand those who are in need of an intervention, those who are at risk of developing negative outcomes. And it's absolutely necessary to target interventions to the more demanding population. It's not only an issue of identifying those who are most care demanding, who are at the highest risk of negative outcomes. But there's another concept that I believe is really important, even if not very described in the literature, which is the issue of impactability. I have a population in great need, at high risk of negative outcomes, very care demanding, have a good intervention. Not necessarily that intervention applies to that kind of population. So every time we stratify and we identify the patient entering the service, we have to be sure that that specific patient can benefit from that specific intervention. And I want to give you a very simple example coming from North America. This is a program to prevent functional decline in physically frail elderly persons. If you look at this intervention, it's extremely, overall, it works. It works well in terms of reducing disability. But when the authors stratify in people with moderate frailty and with very severe frailty, most care-demanding population, they saw that the intervention did work in this group with moderate frailty and not with severe frailty. So it's useless to enroll this kind of population in that specific program. And this is the concept of impactability. We have to be sure that that specific population can get a benefit from that intervention that we are proposing. And last but not least, select a reasonable number of patients is necessary. And the risk stratification, when the patient enters the service or the first contact of the patient with the service, is absolutely necessary. Each kind of stratification tool has a given sensibility and specificity, can be helpful to identify a given number of population. We cannot have services that admit all the population 65 or older, or this is for primary care, basically. So also the stratification tool and the first contact of the patient with the service, we have to be sure we're focusing on the on a patient that can get a benefit from that specific treatment, and we can enroll a reasonable number of patients in that specific program. These are the NICE guidelines. The NICE guidelines are issued by GPs in the United Kingdom, and these are the NICE guidelines for multimorbidity. And what is stated here is that really stratification tools are needed for people with multimorbidity, and the assessment of frailty is necessary in order to identify people who may benefit from an approach to care that accounts for multimorbidity. So these services are not for all people with multimorbidity, but if we address frailty in the multimorbidity context, when we can identify the most care demanding population that may enter the service. How to measure this frailty? And this is really a challenge. How to measure this, how to assess the way of stratifying? Because I agree with Dr. Huber, frailty is probably not a disease, it's not a disease, but frailty should help us to identify most care demanding people, those that need a specific service or need to enter a geriatric service or a specific practice. There are many tools, algorithms that were developed to assess frailty, to screen frailty. Some of them are very well known, such as the CHS criteria, the so-called frailty criteria, the frailty index developed by Rockwood. Some others, some of them are based on specific questionnaires, self-reporters, are those in italic. Some of them are endorsed by public bodies like HEMA that endorsed this one. But there are more than 20. All of them are validated and might be used. The concept and the idea of the joint action advantage is really that all people, all older people, 70 or older, should be screened for frailty. But really, the tool, the choice of the tool, there's no golden standard. So the choice of the tool should be contextualized to the practice priorities, to the practice characteristics, to the number of patients that can be admitted to that specific practice. So it's almost impossible to say, okay, this is the golden standard to measure frailty and to screen frailty in older people to be admitted to a geriatric service, because there's such a heterogeneity across geriatric services and practices focusing on frailty that it's impossible to say, use this tool and this is the tool you need. But the tool, the choice of the tool, should be contextualized to what the practice is doing, the service that is provided, the population that can be admitted to that practice. And I like to report here a short sentence from a manuscript published in the European Journal of Internal Medicine. The author is working for WHO, so I believe that somehow might be also a perspective that WHO is considering. And the authors are stating that frailty measures are horses for courses, wherein different frailty measures are suited to different population. So no gold standard, but choose the right tool for your own population and apply that tool. There are many validated tools in the literature that can be used, and this is somehow one of the main conclusions of the joint action advantages. So first step, screening the patient, I'm a physician, I always talk about patients. I realize these are not patients, these are persons, so forgive me if I do not use the right terminology sometimes. So the first contact with the person, screen, identify those who are in need, who are in greatest need, and can get a benefit from the treatment, and include them in the practice, in the service. The second step is, okay, how can we assess them? How can we assess the complexity that I showed in the very first slide? Well, the answer for us that are geriatricians is very simple, and is the comprehensive geriatric assessment. This is the conclusion of the joint action CRODI, so one of the conclusions of our work package on multimorbidity in the joint action CRODI, where we were focusing on multimorbidity, but we recognize that multimorbidity and disease patterns are a part of the complexity. So if we really want to focus on this population, we also have to consider other factors that are the factors that I presented in the first slide. And so if we really want to target correctly multimorbidity, we need a comprehensive assessment, what is called a comprehensive geriatric assessment, a holistic approach that takes into consideration not only diseases, but also other factors. It's very clear in the scientific literature that this kind of approach is successful. This is a meta-analysis assessing the impact of CGA, comprehensive geriatric assessment, on patient outcomes of in-hospital patients. So these are patients. And it seems that overall, there's a great benefit in favor of the intervention. So where comprehensive geriatric assessment is in place, well, there are good outcomes for the persons, for the patients. And also from an economical perspective, the same article shows that this kind of strategy is cost-saving, especially when we consider nursing home costs. When these costs are taken into consideration, the benefit of the comprehensive geriatric assessment is even greater. And also, not only in hospital, but also when we analyze home visits, it seems that where the multidimensional assessment is in place, where there's a significant benefit for patient, where no multidimensional assessment is in place, well, home visits do not impact at all on patients' outcomes. This concept and the importance of the comprehensive geriatric assessment is now very clear also for non-geriatricians. This is an article from a leading oncologist in the US that is putting at the center of the care of people with cancer, older people with cancer, the comprehensive geriatric assessment as the way of assessing the complexity of this kind of patients. So it's not only an issue or something that geriatricians are saying, but it's now becoming clearer and clearer even in other among other specialties. What are the conclusions of the joint action advantage related to the Flaherty assessment? Well, the conclusions are exactly in line with what I just said, that the gold standard for diagnosing the functional status of the persons is the comprehensive geriatric assessment. It is important when screening is positive to perform a CGA and diagnose frailty by the use of validated scales derived from CGA. So screening, identification of target population, assessment of target population by a given instrument or tools that may allow to have an holistic and full evaluation of this kind of patient or person. Third step is clearly the intervention. Then what should we do then? What is the intervention that should be put in place in a geriatric service or in any kind of practice focusing on frailty? Well, the answer comes here from what we have done in the CRODIS project. Because really, the CRODIS project, I will skip this slide, the CRODIS project was, at least the part we followed, the part on multimorbidity, was really focused on a clinical issue, multimorbidity. But we really recognized, again, that multimorbidity is a part of that complexity and that really a more holistic approach is needed and an approach that takes into account not only multimorbidity, as you can see in the title of this slide, but also frailty. So what we did in the joint action CRODIS, we reviewed the literature looking at programs focusing on multimorbidity and frailty. What we understood published in the scientific literature, there are many, many programs available, but they're extremely heterogeneous and not standardized. What seems very common is that most of these programs were comprehensive and were including different components in the interventions that they were proposing. So there were different aspects, different components that were put together, not single interventions, but really a combination of different kind of interventions. So we also perform a field survey looking for good practices around and presenting some of them, practices that are in our countries, in European countries, that work well in the field of multimorbidity and patients with complex care needs. And we identified some of them that really may provide really good care to people. But again, the program are comprehensive and they are not standardized. It's difficult to say what is the winning point of this kind of practices. So what we did at the end in the joint action CRODIS was really trying to develop a model, or proposing an integrated care model, which is very similar for those of you who know the chronic care model to the chronic care model, and which is based on different aspects, different interventions, different components that should be implemented in a program focused on multimorbidity and frailty, probably. And this program, these components include not only delivery system design, so the importance of the comprehensive generic assessment, the working coordinated teams, the development of individualized care plans, and the case management, but also other aspects, including the decision support system, implementation, such as the implementation of the evidence-based team training, consultation system, the importance of supporting self-management of the patient, so tailored to self-management, options for self-management and shared decision-making, the importance of clinical information systems, so electronic patients' records, exchange patients' info, uniform coding, and patient operating technology, and community resources, so access community resources and involvement in the social network. Not all geriatric services should have all these components implemented in them. But clearly, some of them are key to guarantee an integrated care, a good care pathway for people with frailty and multimorbidity. What is the next step here? This model is a theoretical model, is a theoretical integrated care approach. Next step that will follow in the CRODIS Plus project that is now, that has just started in September this year, will be to put this theory into practice, to put this model into practice and to show, to develop a methodology that can be applied in different countries. We will not be able to apply the same system, the same model in all countries, but we will be able to develop a methodology that can be proposed as a way to implement a theoretical model in different countries with their differences and characteristics. So this is the challenge of the CRODIS Plus project that is really focused on implementing good practices for chronic diseases, in which the theoretical model for practices focused on multimorbidity and frailty will be implemented, and we will find, we'll see if it's feasible to develop such a methodology to implement that model and to export it to different kind, to different countries. So at the end of this presentation, I have to underline three key steps for developing a good geriatric service or a service focused on frailty. So the first of all is screening. Identify the target population, this is key. We can have the best intervention, but if we do not identify the population that is needing of that kind of intervention, we will never get a result. The second step is assessment. So assess the person with that level of complexity, and the CGA is the answer to that. The third one is put in place an intervention, an integrated care model, integrated care intervention that can help to address that level of complexity. But there's a fourth step that I believe is important in a geriatric service, that is the assessment and reassessment and follow-up of what we are doing constantly. So it's important to organize the practice, but it's also important to constantly follow up and reassess the practice, reassess the outcomes that might be patient-level outcomes, but also process indicators telling us that what we're doing is correct and is feasible. And this is also the other challenge of the CRODIS Plus, saying, okay, what we are doing, and the main challenge of the CRODIS Plus is to show that what we are doing is feasible and may bring a contribution, and to assess what we are doing. So, and I showed you earlier the three good practices that we identified in the CRODIS Plus, in the CRODIS project. Why did we identify them as successful and good practices? For the simple reason that they show to be beneficial in terms of quality of care, patient outcomes, and utilization and costs. So that was the key, that is the key to really understand that a given intervention is successful. This is my conclusion, and this is what we have talked about. The challenge is the frailty, is the complexity of frailty that our healthcare systems are not designed to target for. The change is to develop geriatric practices I talk about geriatric practices, but practices focused on frailty are geriatric practices. So geriatric is the type of population, not necessarily the specialists that are working there. And I'm a geriatrician, so I'm talking against my own specialty. But really, if we follow specific rules and specific steps, the service may be set to focus on focusing on geriatric practices, on geriatric patients. So the key steps are screening, and this should be site-specific. This should be the instrument and the tool we choose should be adapted to the characteristics of the population and the intervention. Assessment of patients, and this is the CCGA, the Comprehensive Geriatric Assessment, is the gold standard. The intervention should be based on integrated care model, and it's important every time to assess outcomes and correct and rebuild the practice and make changes in the practice depending on the results we found. I do thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Professor Onder, thank you very much for this really comprehensive overview of frailty. And in particular, to me, it was very dear that you put frailty into the context of other processes that are also going on in terms of developing better health systems, like integration of care. And you linked it so well to the CRODIS project, which is very promising because lots of projects are going on at the level European Union, and they are never linked to each other, which is really sad, but this is how it happens. Here we have a kind of assurance that frailty project, Advantage, will be linked to the CRODIS project. To me, it was very important when you said that we might know what frailty is and definitions are there, but when we approach patients, we should know that each patient is different and we cannot approach patients with one tool or one model of care. I will now give a chance to the audience, and I'm sure that others have also considered what you were talking about and have some questions. So please, prosim, če ima kdo vprašanje, postavite ga našemu gostu.
Let me tell something. It's a great opportunity. It's easy for me because I'm working on both projects, so it's easy for me to link the two projects. But it's a great opportunity to be here and to talk about this, to have opportunities like this kind of conference to share this information together. And also the National Institute of Health, your National Institute of Health, is involved in both initiatives. So it's good to have contact and link, to have contacts and link among different partners in different projects. So it's a reason to say thank again for this conference, which is extremely useful from that point of view.
Dr. Volč, prosim, najprej tukaj vprašanje.
Moje vprašanje je, ali lahko pojem krhkosti razumemo tudi pejorativno, se pravi kot manj vrednostno.
Exactly, that has a negative connotation.
So frailty is a stigma, is this the question?
Yes, a stigma, yeah. Yes.
So I don't know if I got the question correct. Is it related to the fact that frailty is a stigma and it's difficult to recognize for that reason? Is that the question?
Could be, yes, could be. Well, but it depends on us, how we understand it. Do we understand it, let's say, only as a frailty itself? Or is it also something which makes us weaker, also in the eyes of society?
I agree.
In the eyes of healthcare?
So, in the eyes of society, I have to say that there's really poor awareness of what frailty is and that kind of concept. So, one of the key issues of the Joint Action Advantage is really to improve awareness, and we did talk about this with partners, improve people awareness of what frailty is. Because most of the times people say, okay, he's old, he has some problems, there's nothing we can do, which is not exactly the case. So it's somehow also trying to counteract an ageistic approach against the older age, where that is common in several countries. So I have to say, from the patient view, on the person's perspective, there's really poor awareness of frailty. While from the public health perspective, it's really hard to say. It seems clearer and clearer now that this is the kind of person we have to focus on if we really want to not only improve their outcomes, but also improve costs of care. So I would say that from the public health perspective, this is really an important population, because as Dr. Huber was saying, frailty is just a step before disability. It's not end of life, but it's just a step before. If we work on that step, and if we work on frailty and we target frailty, we can really improve the care of the patient, improve the outcomes of the patients, and so reduce the development of negative outcomes and also improve costs. So I see that from a public health perspective, there's attention to this kind of, from a policy perspective, there's attention to this kind of aspect. I don't know if I answer the question. I hope I did.
Še dr. Delina Sedlakova vprašanje.
Thank you very much. I think all this can be also put under one umbrella, ageism and ageistic approaches that we sometimes refer to as really negative connotation of elderly, like being the burden, cost a lot of money, not perspective, and all this. Not nice associations. I'm just referring to one information in your presentation, like screening as of age of 70. This is fixed somewhere, or is it Italian model, or is it outcome of project? Maybe I would go even a little bit
lower
with the age, and I don't know if geriatric care has fixed, for example, is it 65 plus, and I know it differs in Europe, including in Slovakia, there were long debates whether it's 60 plus, 65 plus, or who is a geriatric patient. So, this is also changing in these days. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, we have limited data on frailty prevalence and incidence, because the way of measuring frailty is so heterogeneous that it's difficult to do that. But the reason why we chose 70 is because it seems that after 70, the incident of frailty increases. So we thought that might be an ideal target population for screening. But again, it's based on estimates that may not be very precise, because really the estimates we have, and that's also something we have assessed in the joint action, are for different kind of population using different kind of instruments, so it's not very, very easy to say. But it's an epidemic. I mean, we base that cutoff based on the incidence of frailty.
Še eno vprašanje, dr. Zakotnikova.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your very interesting presentation. I would not have a question, but maybe information about the also status of the, let's say, approach to this kind of problem, which is actually a big challenge for all societies. We developed also in our project, it's about a project called Together for Health, from Norwegian, this financial mechanism, approach to this kind of problem with development of tools for screening of, let's say, population 65 plus. We would like to develop, or we try to develop the system and approach for collaboration between the, our primary healthcare team, primary healthcare doctor team, and our network of health education centers, in which a specially trained physiotherapist for screening for this physical frailty did this screening, tested the, this less functioning in physical ability, and then developed also a set of interventions to, improve the status. And so we try to, let's say, implement the system of this collaboration between team of doctors at primary healthcare level, this health education center, to systematically approach to screening of this population 65 plus, and then to get the target population assess this. Actually, this is not the holistic or not psychosocial aspect, but just physical aspect of this frailty, and then to intervene and to do with this target population, to intervene and then to assess the improvement. So I think that we are on a good way to develop system and also approach to this holistic, let's say, screening and then intervention on this, let's say, set of population which actually are on the way to less functioning on frailty. So thank you for your very interesting in this presentation, which for me was very useful. Thank you.
Thank you. Once more, I don't think there's a gold model that should be applied everywhere, but there's a methodology that is what we are trying to develop in the Chronic Pulse Project, saying, okay, try to follow this kind of methodology that is somehow what you have done in your practice, and to target that level of complexity and to build up a good practice. And it seems that it's in line with what you have done. So I believe the European effort should be not to say, okay, this is the gold model that you have to apply in your system, because it would be impossible to do that, because every system, every region, in Italy we have 21 regions, each region works differently. So it's impossible to say, take this and bring it there, because it will never work. But what we can say, okay, put it in this framework somehow and try to make a successful intervention based on this framework.
Jelka Zaletel.
Thank you, Graziano, for your really interesting lecture. What I would like to add is actually the perspective from the Joint Action Crodis Plus. We work together, the team from National Institute of Public Health, Ministry of Health, and colleague from Italy are connected in, are involved in both joint actions. So maybe to be really sure to understand what will be good for Slovenia, I will now switch to Slovenian. Se pravi, kaj je namen delovanja obeh teh dveh joint actionov konkretno za Slovenijo z vidika projekta skupnega ukrepanja CRODIS Plus za uporabo orodij, ki so bile razvite v prejšnjem joint actionu CRODIS in tudi iz Advantage-a, bomo razvili model za povezovanje med primarno in sekundarno zdravstveno ravnjo in sicer je za bolezensko stanje izbrana kronična rana, kar avtomatično pomeni takoj tudi vključevanje svojcev, patronažne sestre in z vidika razvoja centrov za krepitev zdravja tudi pravzaprav skupnostni pristop. Tako da ne gre, kakorkoli se zdi, da je to neka medicinska zgodba, a ne tukaj le noter zelo veliko teh socialnih in psiholoških vidikov in želimo za uporabo kot rečeno rezultatov obeh joint actionov pripraviti model, ki bo potem prišel poštev za celotno Slovenijo. Tako da imamo veliko priložnost, veliko odgovornost in za brez sodelovanja obeh joint actionov in Evropske komisije tega Slovenija ne bi bila sposobna narediti sama, tako da veliko priložnosti.